Hello all, I am Vinit Krishna. This is the third and final presentation of Module 6 of Subject ME206 Fluid Machinery. This presentation is the continuation of the second part. So from where we stopped in the second part, we will continue from there itself. Now here we will see theoretical or Euler's work done in an axial flow compressor. The general form of Euler's work done for a turbine is given by work done per second equal to m dot into Vw1 u1 plus or minus Vw2 u2, where m dot stands for mass flow rate, Vw1, Vw2 stands for whirl components of velocity at inlet and outlet respectively. Also u1 and u2 stands for blade velocities at inlet and outlet respectively. Now that was for a turbine. But when it comes to a compressor, we can rewrite the equation as work done per second equal to m dot into Vw2 u2 plus or minus Vw1 u1. Now this is because of the basic working difference in the case of a turbine and compressor. You know the basic difference between a turbine and compressor. So with respect to that, we can rewrite the equation. Also, if you remember, we have already seen that the angle beta can have three possibilities. Beta angle can be equal to 90 degree, it can be larger than 90 degree, or it can be less than 90 degree. Here in this case, beta angle is acute. That means for compressor, we need to choose negative sign inside the bracket. Also, we can see that the blade velocity u1 can be represented by CBL1, u2, CBL2. And in the case of an axial flow compressor, the blade velocity remains constant, remains the same throughout. That is, we can use CBL, blade velocity constant, CBL1 equal to CBL2 equal to CBL. Similarly, we can represent VW1, VW2 as CW1 and CW2 respectively, so that we can write the equation for work done, Euler's work done per second equal to m dot into CW2 minus CW1 into CBL. For unit mass flow rate, for unit mass, we can write work done per second equal to CW2 minus CW1 into CBL. We can omit the term m dot. Now this is the final equation representing theoretical or Euler's work done in the case of an axial flow compressor. Now this is the actual work input given to the compressor. Next topic we are going to see is degree of reaction. Degree of reaction, R suffix D, can be defined as the ratio of pressure rise in the rotor blades to the pressure rise in a compressor stage. Now we know that the pressure rise in the rotor blades is due to the centrifugal effect, which can be represented as CR1 square minus CR2 square divided by 2, where CR1 and CR2 stands for relative velocities at inlet and outlet respectively. Also, we have the equation to find pressure rise in a compressor stage, which is equal to work input per stage, which we can write as CW2 minus CW1 into CBL. So that we can write the equation to find degree of reaction R suffix D as CR1 square minus CR2 square divided by 2 into CW2 minus CW1 into CBL. Now this equation, we can name it as equation number 1, the equation to find degree of reaction. We will be substituting for CR1, CR2, CW2 and CW1 into this equation, that is equation number 1, to establish some relationship, which we will see in the upcoming slides. Now how we are going to do that? We will do with the help of relationship from our outlet and inlet velocity triangles of an axial flow compressor. Now in the next slide, I will be showing the velocity triangles again, so that it will be helpful for us. So if you remember the outlet and inlet velocity triangles of an axial flow compressor, we can establish the relationship for CW2 and CW1 as CW2 equal to CBL2 minus CF2 into tan beta 2, equation A. CW1 equal to CBL1 minus CF1 into tan beta 1, which we can name it as equation B. Now here CF2 and CF1 stands for flow components of velocity at outlet and inlet respectively. So taking A minus B, that is equation A minus equation B, we can write CW2 minus CW1 equal to CF into tan beta 1 minus tan beta 2. This is because the flow component of velocity remains the same, so that we can write CF2 equal to CF1 equal to CF. Now this equation we can name it as equation C. So if you look at equation 1, we can see that the denominator term CW2 minus CW1, the term which is coming inside the bracket, here itself we got the result. The rest of the terms like CR1, CR2, we will see in the upcoming slide. I hope you all have seen these diagrams before. Now these are the velocity diagrams of an axial flow compressor, both inlet and outlet velocity diagram you can see here. Here you can see all the velocity components and different angles, but do remember one thing, we are using the term C, that is alphabet C, to represent all the velocity components, whereas in the diagram you can see the velocity components are being represented by the alphabet V. So I believe I have reminded you all regarding this usage of alphabet to represent velocity components in part 2 itself. Anyway, I just wanted to remind you all again. So here in the figure of velocity diagrams, all the velocity components, absolute velocity, relative velocity, flow component of velocity, world component of velocity, all the velocity components are being represented by the alphabet V, whereas in our derivation we are using C. Also the blade velocity, instead of U we are using CBL. So please do remember all these things. Now since we saw the inlet and outlet velocity triangles of an axial flow compressor, we can continue with the derivation here. So again, from the inlet and outlet velocity triangles, we can write CR1 square equal to CF1 square plus CF1 tan beta 1 square, which we can name it as equation D. Similarly, from outlet velocity triangle, we can write CR2 square equal to CF2 square plus CF2 tan beta 2 square, whole square, which we can name it as equation E. So equation D minus equation E will give CR1 square minus CR2 square equal to CF2 square into tan beta 1 square minus tan beta 2 square, which we can name it as equation F. Now substituting the values of equation C, equation F, in equation 1. Equation 1, if you remember, it was an equation to find the degree of reaction, so that we can write R suffix D, degree of reaction, equal to substituting the values from equation C and F into equation 1 will give CF2 square into tan beta 1 square minus tan beta 2 square divided by 2 into CF into tan beta 1 minus tan beta 2 into CBL. That is R suffix D equal to 1 by 2 into CF by CBL into tan beta 1 plus tan beta 2. Now here we will substitute for degree of reaction, that is the value of degree of reaction R suffix D is usually taken as 0.5. So we will substitute that value into the above equation and we can write 0.5 equal to 1 by 2, which is 0, into CF by CBL into tan beta 1 plus tan beta 2, which we can rearrange and write CBL by CF equal to tan beta 1 plus tan beta 2, which we can name it as equation G. Now again from inlet velocity triangle, we can write tan alpha 1 plus tan beta 1 equal to CW1 plus CBL minus CW1 by CF. that is tan alpha 1 plus tan beta 1 equal to CBL divided by CF, which we name it as equation H. Similarly, from outlet velocity triangle, we can write tan alpha 2 plus tan beta 2 equal to CW2 plus CBL minus CW2 divided by CF, which will be reduced to tan alpha 2 plus tan beta 2 equal to CBL by CF, which we name it as equation I. So right now we have all the equations with us. Now comparing equations G, H and I will give CBL by CF, which is equal to tan beta 1 plus tan beta 2 equal to tan alpha 1 plus tan beta 1 equal to tan alpha 2 plus tan beta 2. So if you observe this relationship with all these angles, you can conclude like this: alpha 1 should be equal to beta 2 and alpha 2 should be equal to beta 1. Thus, for degree of reaction 0.5, the compressors must have symmetrical blades, and with this type of blade angles, losses in flow paths generally reduced. Performance characteristics of axial compressors. The performance characteristics of axial flow compressors at various speeds can be represented by using the following plots. Two cases. First case, pressure ratio, power, efficiency versus flow rate. Now, out of the three plots, pressure ratio versus flow rate is important. That is P2 by P1 versus M dot, that is the flow rate. Now, the second case being pressure ratio versus non-dimensional flow rate. So, here the y-axis remains the same, that is pressure ratio P2 by P1 versus on the x-axis, it's a function of mass flow rate, stagnation point temperature, stagnation point pressure, that is T01 and P01 respectively. You can see the performance characteristic curves of an axial flow compressor. Now on the y-axis you can see power, efficiency and pressure ratio, and on the x-axis you can see mass flow rate. So for a particular speed, efficiency increases with increase in flow rate and reaches a maximum value, and after that, if you further increase the flow rate, the efficiency decreases. That's how the efficiency varies. Now talking about the power, you can see the power consumption increases with the increase in flow rate. So as you increase the flow rate, the power consumption also increases. Now next you can see a dotted line over here. It is called surge line. In order to understand surge line completely, you need to know surging. So you do have a topic, surging and choking, and we will study that surging and choking, that process, in detail in the upcoming slides. So as of now, you understand one thing. Now this surge line can be obtained by joining all the surge points. Now how do we get this surge point? Surge point for a particular speed, let's say N1, it's over here. Surge point comes here. Now this is the point where a compressor will have the peak capability, that is peak pressure ratio with minimum flow rate. Beyond this, if you decrease the flow rate, the pressure ratio will come down. So this is for a particular compressor at this RPM, that is N1 speed, will be having higher pressure ratio with minimum flow rate. Similarly, for the same compressor for another speed, N2, this is the point where the compressor will have higher pressure ratio with minimum flow rate. This is the surge point for that particular speed. Similarly, for the speed N3, the compressor will be having the peak point here, that is pressure ratio, maximum pressure ratio with minimum flow rate at this point, surge point. Another surge point over here. So similarly, if you join all the search points using this dotted line, that dotted line will be called search line. So basically search line is just a collection of all the search points. Anyway, like I said, you will be studying as well as choking in the upcoming slides. So that time we will see the processes searching and choking in detail. Performance of a compressor is usually specified by curves of pressure ratio against mass flow rate for various fixed values of rotational speed and inlet temperature. Now, this kind of performance characteristic curves are usually plotted with non-dimensional variables. For example, in this figure, you can see instead of flow rate on the x-axis, we have taken a function of mass flow rate, stagnation temperature, and stagnation pressure. So, in order to convert it into non-dimensional quantities, we have taken stagnation properties, stagnation pressure, and stagnation temperature at inlet. Also, you can see in the y-axis, instead of pressure P1 and P2, we have taken P02 and P01. Either also, we have taken stagnation property. And the shape of the surge line, everything else is almost same. Thing is, the values has been changed because we are dealing with stagnation properties here. Now I believe you know how to obtain the search line just by joining all the search points. So search line, like I said, it's basically a collection of all the search points. Ideal and actual performance curves for an axial flow compressor. Now, due to various losses, the actual performance curve will always come below the ideal curve. The performance of a compressor is defined according to its design. But in actual practice, what happens is the operating point of the compressor deviates from the design point, which is known as off-design operation. So here you can see a stable operation region and unstable operation region. And how do we understand where is stable and where is unstable? For example, in this plot, the line separating the graph between two regions like unstable and stable is known as the surge line, and we can see the surge point over there. Now this surge line is formed by joining surge points at different RPMs, like I said earlier. So unstable flow is like unstable flow in an axial flow compressor due to complete breakdown of the steady through flow is termed as surging. Anyway, we will study surging in the upcoming slide. Now this phenomena affects the performance of a compressor and is undesirable. So the unstable region is undesirable. We don't want that. We want the stable region only. And due to this, due to different like various losses, the actual performance curve will always come below the ideal performance curve. Now these are the parameters often used to characterize an axial flow compressor, or let's call them as design parameters as of now. Now those are flow coefficient, work or head coefficient, pressure coefficient. Now flow coefficient, or represented as phi f, is defined as the ratio of axial flow velocity, that is cf, of air to blade tangential velocity, cbl. Now it is designated as phi f. So it is basically the ratio of axial flow velocity of air to tangential blade velocity. Now next is work coefficient or head coefficient, designated as phi suffix h, phi h. Now it is defined as the ratio of actual work done on the air to the kinetic energy corresponding to the mean peripheral velocity of the blade, that is mcp t2 minus t1. That is the actual work done on the air divided by half mcbl square, that is kinetic energy corresponding to mean peripheral velocity of the blade. Now the last one is pressure coefficient, designated as phi suffix p. Now phi suffix p is equal to mcp t2 dash minus t1 divided by half mcbl square. That is pressure coefficient designated by phi p is defined as the ratio of isentropic work done in the compressor to kinetic energy corresponding to mean peripheral velocity of the blade. Now work or head coefficient, it was in the case of work coefficient, it was actual work done on air, whereas in the case of 5p, that is pressure coefficient, it is isentropic work done. The denominator remains same. Also you can see that if you observe the coefficients, that is pressure coefficient and work or head coefficient, you can establish a relationship. Phi p equal to isentropic efficiency into work or head coefficient. Next we will see losses in compressor. Losses in compressor means pressure loss inside the compressor. This may arise due to three factors mainly. First one is profile losses on the surface of blades. Second one, skin friction losses on the annulus walls. Third one, secondary flow losses or incidence losses. First one, profile losses. Now this is due to friction between air and the surface of blades. Separation of boundary layer occurs when adverse pressure gradient on surface becomes too steep, thereby increasing profile loss. Second one, skin friction losses on the annulus walls. This is due to friction between air and the annulus walls of the compressor. Third one and the last one, secondary flow losses or incidence losses. Now these losses are due to combined effects of curvature of blade and bound formation. They are produced when there is a bend or when a sheared flow passes over a compressor blade or boundary layer meets an obstacle. So these three are the main three factors which causes losses in compressor. As I said earlier, we are going to see surging as well as choking in detail here. So let's see some statements regarding surging as of now. After that we will see, once surging is done, we will see choking. So surge is the occurrence of backflow of air in a compressor. Surge occurs when the compressor has to operate at less mass flow rate than the predetermined value or design value. When the flow in the compressor is reduced than this predetermined value, surging can occur, which may result in the mechanical failure of the compressor. Severe surge can bend the rotor shaft. Now these are the few points or statements regarding surging. Now I would like to remind you all that we have already seen the graph pressure ratio versus mass flow rate, and I believe you already saw the surge line, how to obtain the surge line, all those details I believe I have explained earlier. So you might have seen that the surge line separates stable region from the unstable region, right? Anyway, we shall see the same graph pressure ratio versus mass flow rate in the next slide, and we shall see surges, choking process in detail. Now here you can see the plot pressure ratio versus mass flow rate for a compressor. Now the point L in the graph is known as surge point. You can see the point L. That point is known as surge point. Now on the section LP of the curve, the flow is stable. Whereas on the section OL of the curve, the flow is unstable. That is, a fall in the mass flow rate will result in the reversal of flow, thus resulting in fall in pressure ratio. That is, if you decrease the mass flow rate, it will result in the reversal of flow, as well as it will result in decrease in the pressure ratio. The pressure ratio will come down. Thus, on sections left to surge point L, reversal of flow takes place and surging phenomena happens here, over here. Now, thus reversal of flow happens for a short period only. After that, the flow becomes normal. But these oscillations of flow, that is reversal of flow, is noisy and cause structural damage in the compressor. Thus, surging needs to be dead. It can be seen that at the surge point L, the pressure ratio of the compressor is maximum. Thus, the operating point of the compressor is always near to the surge point. The operating point is shown as M. Now, we can avoid surging by two ways. One is by installing a spillback valve, and second by operating the compressor in the operating. That's how we can avoid surging. Now we will see choking. Now we can use the same graph what we saw in the previous slide to explain surging, pressure ratio versus mass flow rate. The same plot we can use it here also to explain choking. Now choking point occurs at point P. You can see the choking point labeled P. Now choking occurs at point P under which the mass flow rate is too large and there is sudden decrease in pressure ratio. Now during choking condition, the pressure ratio becomes unity. That is, there is no compression at all. Now at point P, the speed of the air reaches sonic and the compressor performance decreases abruptly. After choking point, that is after point P, the graph becomes vertical in nature. You can see after point P, after choking point, the graph becomes vertical. Now this shows that the pressure ratio reduces to unity after choking point. There is another phenomena called stalling. Now in simple words, we can put it like this. Stalling is the separation of flow from the blade surface. A partial blockage or uneven flow of air in the blade passages due to change of angle of incidence of air is known as stalling. Now that's the definition. Now stalling may occur due to lesser flow rate than the desired value, or it can occur due to non-uniformity in the blade profile. Now you can see in the figure, as the angle of attack increased, the separation of flow from the blade surface occurred. That is stalling. Now this is the end of this presentation. With this, we will conclude module 6 of the subject ME206 fluid machinery. Now please feel free to contact me to know the references I have used. Thank you all.